Good evening. My name is Heidi Stalla. I'm director of the writing program at NYU Abu Dhabi, and I'm delighted to welcome you all here on behalf of the NYU Abu Dhabi Institute. This is the Institute's fifth year of programming in Abu Dhabi and hosts of a variety of events, performances, and public lectures such as this one, different cultural and intellectual activities. This is actually the second artist talk this week. The first one was the opening of photographer Nadia Benchalal's exhibit entitled Sisters, which is at our downtown campus, and you are all warmly invited to come see this exhibit. Please see the Institute website for viewing times. I am delighted to welcome my friend Angela Palmer here tonight. Her approach to creativity and knowledge has been inspirational to me since I met her 15 years ago. I was trying to figure out a way to concisely introduce her and her work this evening, but the problem is it's impossible to sum up the work of an artist who doesn't seem to believe in limits. For example, she spoke to our students last night about her most recent project, Ghost Forest. Fueled by a deep awareness of environmental issues, she went to Ghana and almost single-handedly brought back chunks of rainforest to install in London, Copenhagen, Oxford, and Wales. Her goal is to create spaces for people to think, react, and feel, and she insists she is not an activist. But what better way to start a conversation about deforestation and climate change? I could say her work explores the boundaries of art and science, but even this risks too much labeling. Pinning something down, even giving something a title, seems to be something she resists. She has collaborated with scientists, engineers, archaeologists, musicologists. I just found out that she has set the sutures of her skull to music. She has shared her work with the likes of President of Ghana, Kofi Annan, Michelle Obama, and Sheikh Mohammed. Her work was even fictionalized last year in Robert Harris's most recent novel, The Fear Index, which is a thriller about artificial intelligence. So I won't try to sum her work up, but I will invite her to talk to you about her creative process, the way she turns chutzpah and curiosity, two qualities which I think lead to great science and great art, into powerful expression. So welcome, Angela.
I think before I start my talk, I just should perhaps set my work in context and how I came to do this work. I was at art school in Edinburgh. I'm Scottish and from the northeast of Scotland, and I was at art school in Edinburgh. And I almost finished a year of my schooling at art school when I got the bug for horses, and I really, really spent far too much time being a bit naughty and applying for jobs overseas, would you believe, to muck out horses. My mother was absolutely horrified by this and intercepted a letter which arrived at the house with a stamp on it, a franc stamp, and it was the Scotsman newspapers. When I was at school, I'd edited a couple of copies of the school magazine, and I'd completely forgotten this, but I'd written to the Scotsman asking if I could be a journalist when I grow up. And so a few years later, they had written to me and saying there is a vacancy. My mother intercepted it and said, quite scary, my mother, you will apply for this job. So she was absolutely thrilled when I got the job as a trainee on the evening news in Edinburgh. I was absolutely horrified, but to my amazement, I really did knuckle down. And I did 3 years as a trainee journalist. And I think a lot of my journalism informs my art that I do now. I then went to London. Bill Deeds, who some of you might have heard of, Lord Deeds of Scoop fame, was the editor, and he took me on to work on something called the Peterborough Column. And then I went to work on the Times, where I edited the Printing House Square, a political column on the Times. And then I went to the Observer as the youngest female news editor, which was a very, very scary prospect. And I did that for 2 years. And then I edited the Observer magazine for 4 years, and then went on to edit Elle magazine. And that was quite a jump, a leap from going from a fairly left-wing political newspaper to basically a magazine for frocks. And it didn't really suit me terribly well. There I was, houses were burning, people were dying. And the main concern was whether or not you had a front row at the Paris fashion shows. So my husband subsequently got a job actually in Hong Kong. So we moved there, and I had a problem with the childbirth of my third child, Rosie, which meant that I had bed rest. I was enforced to lie in a government hospital bed for 8 weeks. And it was at that time, really in desperation to keep me sane, that I sort of imagined that my room was a studio, and I started drawing and painting again. So every time anyone brought me any flowers, anything at all, I drew them, I painted them. I think I painted every Wind in the Willows illustration in the children's books. And then when I came back to London, actually it was Oxford, we didn't return to London, we went to live in Oxford, I thought that I would finish my fine art degree. I'd only done a year, so I signed up to the Ruskin. When I say I signed up, I got in to the Ruskin as an undergraduate. And it was there that I met Heidi. So that's how this circle has been closed this evening. Heidi was teaching our entire family tennis. An extraordinarily talented woman she is. And I said to her, look, I've got a possibility of getting into Oxford. And she suggested that I apply to Exeter, where Heidi was the dean, trying to keep the undergraduates under control. So Oxford was an extraordinary place. The Ruskin is a very interesting art school because you have access to the medical sciences in the university, and you can actually draw, study, investigate the corpses, and draw like Leonardo did. I think it's probably the only art school in the world that allows students this privilege, and it does sound very gory. And it is quite shocking in the beginning. But all the corpses are people who've died of natural causes. They're all very, very old people. And in the beginning, you don't actually, I don't know, you don't see the heads, but you do after a few weeks, and they think that you're inured to it. So it's a bit like becoming a nurse, I guess. You get used to it. But it became completely compelling and fascinating for me to have this privilege, to see the way the human body works, to look below the surface. And I went on to work with CT and MRI scans, and I will explain to you in a second and show you some of the work I did. I did go on to do some environmental work. I had a dream. One night, I had this dream that I was wearing an identical white outfit, and I went to the most polluted place in the world and the cleanest place in the world, and I used this white outfit as a blank canvas to record, if you like, the extreme atmospheric conditions in both places. And when I woke up, I thought, I shall do this. I went on the internet, and I found the most polluted place in the world is a place called Linfen in Shaanxi province in China, which is very heavy industry. It's about 850 kilometers southwest of Beijing. So I traveled there, and I also went to the cleanest place in the world, which is a place called Cape Grim, extraordinary name, next to Suicide Bay and Dismal Swamp. It's in the northwest tip of Tasmania. So what was exciting about that place, when I got to those places, sure, as you would imagine, the outfit went from white to black in a very short time in Linfen and remained pristine in Tasmania. But the excitement of art is that you just cannot predict it. And what was extraordinary was that the real essence that I got from this trip was the difference in the spirit in both places. And maybe it's because of the bleakness for the Chinese, but their spirit was extraordinary. It was electrifying on the streets, and so I filmed there. They were exercising, they were playing games, they were interacting. They had incredible joie de vivre. And I did speak to them about, the ones who spoke English, I did talk to them about, obviously I was the only Westerner there. And they said there was nothing they could do about it but just live their lives in the most positive and extraordinary way. So it was the films which I juxtaposed that really made this piece. I went directly to Tasmania, to this place, this town just outside Cape Grim, where they've been taking air quality samples for years, since 1970 actually. It is certainly the cleanest place in the world. But it also came over as being almost the most sterile place and not so unlike quite a lot of places that one goes to in Europe today. In England, it seemed like the more money people had, the more distant they were from their own communities. So they were living in the end. What you had were people behind net curtains, all watching television with their picket fences up, and they had a bit more money, and you could see they put up a wall, and a bit more money than that, and they would put up electrified fences, and it just seemed that they were distancing themselves all the time from their communities, and it was very difficult for me to talk to people about it. I told them what I was doing, but they didn't want to really discuss it. It didn't mean anything to them that they were in the cleanest place in the world. And so it was an interesting exercise for me in the unexpected. I then went on and met a scientist who told me that a rainforest the size of a football pitch is being destroyed every 4 seconds. Can you imagine? Every 4 seconds. I was so horrified by this. I thought, as an artist, surely I could visually express this. And so I went to find a rainforest. I thought, I'll find a commercially logged rainforest. I'll bring out the tree stumps. I'll create a ghost forest. And I'll try and put it right in the middle of London. So and somehow it worked, and we put it into Trafalgar Square, this ghost forest. And then it was outside, it was just at the feet of Nelson's Column. And Nelson's Column stands 169 feet tall. And these trees grow that height in the forest. And if you ever go to Trafalgar Square, just stand at the feet of Nelson's Column and look up. It's a dizzying height. And then I took the trees to Copenhagen. Then they were in Oxford for 2 years. And then they're now in Wales. But it was really done because I've got 3 children, and I just thought, one of these days, these children have got every right to turn around to me and say, your generation knew. Because when these trees are gone, they're gone. But you did nothing about it. So I felt impelled to try and do something about it. So I created this ghost forest. If you have a look, perhaps on the website Ghost Forest, you will see this project. But the other work I do, it's really about mapping my work. Heidi said it's difficult to pin down, but I know what drives me is a sort of, certainly there's a curiosity, but there's also a real deep interest I have in mapping. Anyway, I'd really like to show you my work now on the making the invisible visible, because that's what a lot of my work is about. And I've got a few slides I'd like to share with you. First of all, I'd like to show you this picture here. It's important to me because, it's called Old Woman Cooking Eggs. And some of you may be familiar with this picture. It's by Velasquez, and it was painted in 1618. It's in the National Gallery in Scotland. And that is the picture, when I was a little girl, that I saw, and it just stopped me in my tracks. You know that moment when suddenly you just feel an intake of breath? And it was, for me, that picture. It's very, very powerful when you see it. And as you can see, there is this great impact with the use of light and shade, the chiaroscuro, the light coming from the left and hitting the figures, the translucency of the white of the egg becoming white. It's a fantastically powerful and arresting painting. And here Velasquez he's in control of what we are looking at. He's directing us to what he wants us to see. So it's a naturalistic, realistic rendition. He's using all the skill of the eye that he had in this painting. Now the eye, of course, since ancient times, We've been trying to improve on the eye, on our vision. And there we had Robert Hooke. In the late 17th century, he was looking at the microscope and he got everyone very, very excited. He was looking at things like fleas. And people had never seen the details of these fleas. He was the first one, I believe, to use the word cell to describe the most basic form of human life. And Samuel Pepys read his book, Micrographia, and he said he stayed up till 2 a.m. because it was the most ingenious book he'd ever read in this documentation of organisms. Then we've got Brownian motion. So when Robert Brown used a microscope to look at pollen grains suspended in water in 1827, he observed that the pollen grains were constantly moving around as if they were being jostled by something. And the particle model explains this so-called Brownian motion as being caused by water particles which vibrate and are able to move, bumping the pollen grains. So things at that point, 1827 we're talking about here, people were realizing there was a lot more going on beneath the surface than met the eye. This, I don't know if you're familiar with this gentleman, Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen. Now in 1895, he accidentally discovered a new form of radiation. And he used it to capture an image which on his wife, and this is clearly revealing her wedding ring and her bones. And this photograph absolutely electrified the general public and attracted a lot of scientific interest. He named it X radiation, X, of course, standing for the unknown. And in the meantime, photography was leaping ahead, and moving images were being captured on film, and this is more evidence was being gathered that the human eye could not be trusted to tell the whole story of what was going on in front of it. And artists were beginning to understand and reflect this and wanting to see beneath the surface. So in the same year as this X-ray was developed, the Lumiere brothers developed the cinematograph, which could record a moving image as well as a static image. And then the cubists were also working. Braque and Picasso were working together so closely that Braque described them as being as if they were being held together with a rope like climbers on a cliff face. So this was around the early 1900s. They were experimenting with the depiction of space, mass, and volume. And Picasso and Braque, they were rejecting this naturalism, this traditional approach of copying nature, of using perspective, modeling, foreshortening, as we saw in the Velasquez picture. They wanted to describe in visual terms the fourth dimension and depict the world as it is and not as it seems. They wanted to depict objects from multiple viewpoints, and by doing this, simultaneously, they implied the fourth dimension, time. So they broke down form, and you can see that you could view people from multiple or contrasting vantage points. Now here we have, this is Woman Descending the Staircase by Duchamp. And if you have a look at this image, it's very interesting. You're looking at a sort of mechanistic motion. So we've got dynamism here as well as this fractured facets. So you can see what is happening here. There's the movement. Long gone is the foreshortening. There's no background, there's no foreground. They're just showing this dynamism, this movement of the futurists, who were experimenting, of course, in movement at that time. So this is a new Descending the Staircase. This was 1912. Now this is Picasso. I guess you'll be all familiar with this too. This is Weeping Woman. This was painted in 1937. And this is a really good example, I think, of going beneath the surface. You're seeing her from multiple viewpoints, but also you are going under the surface as if she has been X-rayed. I'd like to read you Jonathan Jones. He's an art critic. I think he's one of the best art critics writing at the moment. And his view of the Weeping Woman, he says, "This is a study of how much pain can be communicated by human face. Let your eyes wander over the sharp surface, and you are led by the jagged black lines in the picture's center, her mouth and chin, where the flesh seem to be peeled away by corrosive tears to reveal hard white bone. The handkerchief is like a shard of glass. Her eyes are black apertures. When you are inside this picture, you are inside pain. And I thought that that was an extremely powerful description of this work. In 1945, Dorothy Hodgkin, who's a great heroine of mine, and you will understand shortly, she was working on X-ray crystallography, leading her to discover the three-dimensional nature of biomolecular structures. And in 1953, here is Crick and Watson discovering the structure of the DNA molecule. And here we have the double helix, the model serving to explain how DNA replicates and how hereditary information is coded on it. And of course, leading us to discover how closely related we all are underneath the surface. And here we have the MRI scanner, which again is very germane to my work, which you will discover in a moment. And then of course we go on to today. We're just seeing further advances in imaging, combining with digital technology, which enabling us to record and manipulate massive amounts of data. So Oxford, here I am at the Ruskin School of Art, and I've been working and drawing these extraordinary corpses and trying to understand the inside of the body. And one day, I took my children to the History of Science Museum in Oxford. I was always trying to get my children interested in museums. And like all children, sort of, you know, that size, I wasn't getting much change from them. But my eye lit on a model that day. Now, this model was made by Dorothy Hodgkin. It's rather extraordinary. She constructed this model in the 1940s. With a thick black pen, Hodgkin has drawn the electron density contour images of the penicillin molecule on horizontal sheets of perspex. Now, these are separated at each four corners, you can see, with metal nuts. And the molecules take on this three-dimensional image. And as I gazed at this, I got very excited. It's a very, very beautiful object. But what she was showing to me suggested that I could take slices of the human head in the same way, adapt it in the same way, but turn it from a horizontal onto a vertical plane. And could I therefore show the entire inner architecture of the human head? So I went to Blackwell's bookshop in Oxford, and I found a book from Cambridge University, actually, and they had frozen the corpse and taken slices of it, which I then took details of, and on a perspex sheeting, I started experimenting. And there was this woman being recreated, this old lady's face being recreated before my eyes. So I went to the physiology department at Oxford and asked if I could have more slices of bodies, a bit like Burke and Hare, I fear. And they said, well, of course we can't give you more slices. There is a bit of a paucity of slices of corpses in the university, but why don't you go and get yourself MRI'd and recreate your own head? So there I am. And I was sitting after they took 14 slices of my head. Actually, they did my whole body. I'm going to show you a few images. But I remember sitting in the suite of the X-ray department saying, my God, what an enormous brain. And there was total silence because apparently it's a perfectly normal brain. But I had never, I just looked like fireman's hoses, I thought. It's huge. And the eye is just extraordinary. So here we have, as you can see, we've got different parts of my body you're now about to see. I'm going to share with you. There is obviously a magnificent spine. And there's my paw, and that's... So these are all just body parts, which I then plan to use, which you will see in a second. There's my knee. I've got very dodgy knees, but it doesn't really show there. And here is the first, one of the first pieces I did. So I took the outline of the MRI scans, and then I took the internal parts, so that I was kind of staring at myself, and these are engraved on about 14, these are on 14 sheets of glass. So you can perhaps begin to see the three-dimensional image here. These are cutouts. I cut out the outline of my body that the MRI scan had created, and I just exploded it out, and it looks rather like a crustacean. And here, I put each, these were in Perspex sheets, and as you can see here, I put each Perspex sheet, one on top of the other. Now, I live next door to the canon of the university church. Quite handy, really. So I asked him if we could show this piece in his church. So when we put it down, he said he couldn't really tell whether people were going to think that this was a body emerging or a body descending. So here you're going to, I'll show you my portrait here. This, so imagine that is my head, whack, right through the middle section. And that is the work I created. That's a drawn piece. So I've just replicated the Dorothy Hodgkin idea of just taking a black pen with the details. And there I have taken an engraver. I experimented with engraving. And in fact, perhaps with the engraving one, you get a slightly more ethereal feel. From the side, when you walk to the side, everything disappears. But when you see it head on, it looks like it's just floating in space. Now, I then met Mark Lithgow, who's a neuroscientist, and he was looking at brains of mathematicians. He looked at someone called Carol Vorderman and put her, she's a brilliant mathematician, he put her into a MRI scanner and asked her questions on figures and patterns to see if there was any different parts of her brain lighting up. But he allowed me to go into the scanner, and so you can see there's my nose and my eyes. And then I've cut my head in two. So it looks like I have, it's just like an apple that I've cut in two, but it gives you quite a good view here, I think, of the three-dimensionality of this work. And there's a picture there of me in the scanner. This is an upright scanner. I don't know if any of you have ever seen an upright scanner or whether you've even got them here. This was one of the, when I did this, there was only two in Europe, one in Aberdeen, where I was born, strangely, and one in Madrid. And these scanners are really to look at the spine, because when you're lying down, you get a completely different view of what's going on with the spine medically than you do when you're standing up, apparently, when you are when you're load-bearing. They're also very good for people who are extremely obese who don't fit into these scanners, because a lot of people are obese because they've got some sort of tumor which makes them overeat. And these scanners have revolutionized the life of a lot of people. They had 100% success rate of people who were sent from Glasgow, a hospital in Glasgow, to Aberdeen, to this brilliant professor. And these obese people could stand on, just as we see here, and they could identify the tumor, and their life changed forever. However, my idea was to go and to get into a crouching position, a completely different position, and that, so there I am, absolutely crouching. It was one of the most painful things I've ever done. I felt like, it doesn't look painful, but I can assure you it was, because this was over a 6-hour period, with I got some the odd breaks. And there I am, absolutely squashed up. And it's just, I only pick up what the MRI scanner picks up, so it wasn't picking up my forearms. So those flowers are actually my knuckles. You can see a little bit closer there. This is also me. So you can see I've been at a slight angle in the scanner. This is where I thought I wanted to do the Edward Munch, this sort of the scream. So I went to my dentist and I said, how do I keep my mouth open? So he gave me this rubber device, which I put into my mouth. But that was equally painful, because just holding your mouth open and not being able to swallow is horrific. So all that you can imagine, the saliva pouring down my face. Anyway, of course, anything for art. So here we go. So these are the scans that came out of this. They managed to put them on this really quite extraordinary program. And there, huge brain again. And look at those eyes. I mean, just what you're seeing, I find it extraordinary. I do find that the inner architecture, as I was saying, of the human is just beautiful. And there I've engraved that piece. And that was, I did the two together, so having a bit of an argument with myself. Now this one here, you wouldn't guess perhaps immediately what this is, but this is the sinuses of a cow. I got together with the Royal Veterinary College in Hertfordshire, a wonderful woman called Renata Weller, professor of radiology, and I'd always wanted actually to do a horse. I went down to see her to discuss this, and she said, well, hang on a minute, I've been doing some work on cattle, because we're looking at sinuses in cattle, and we want to see if we can find a more efficient way of giving the TB injection to cattle in the third world. And one of the ways was to look at investigating the sinuses to see if they could find a spray for cattle. And I think these sinuses are just absolutely stunning. And there he is again with his big eyes. And that's the cow. Here he is. So again, you're seeing him better from a three-dimensional. That's him. He's floating there. It's like a heavy weight floating in glass. And in fact, this one now is at the Royal Veterinary College because I collaborate with all these scientists, but I always insist on giving them a piece of my work. So that one was given to them a few weeks ago. And then she phoned up, Renata phoned up in huge excitement, and I knew that she'd managed to get a horse. So I went zooming down to Hertfordshire. And when I met her, she just had this black bag, a bit sort of Godfather-esque, and we were on the way to the CT scanner. The horse went into the CT scanner, and I heard some expletives as we were looking at the screen from Renata, not renowned to hold back. And I said, what's the problem? Damn, she said, the black areas. And I said, what was it? Is it disease? Because she doesn't, the doctors and the veterinarians didn't want me to do a diseased animal. So the black area was actually because the head was frozen. It hadn't defrosted. So I had to return. So you see now, there he is. That's the head of this horse. But then I went on to do another horse, Eclipse. Eclipse is the most famous racehorse probably in the world. He was racing in the 1700s, unbeaten. And something like 95% of all thoroughbred racehorses today can be traced directly to Eclipse. And they have the skull of Eclipse at the Royal Veterinary College. And so I was able to reproduce the head of Eclipse. Now you may wonder what's going on here. This is the John Radcliffe Hospital. A friend of mine sent me a cutting from the Times to say that Tutankhamun had been scanned. And he said, why didn't you go and reproduce the head of Tutankhamun? How exciting would that be? So I rang up the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford and said, may I speak to the Egyptologists, please? So this lady answered the phone and I said, do you think there's any possibility that I could reproduce the head of Tutankhamun? And she said, you must be joking. She said, these people will not talk to us. They're never going to talk to a student at art school. Forget it. So I said, oh, well, you know, I really always believe you've got to try. So just as I was putting the phone down, she said, but we do have an Egyptian mummy here that we know nothing about. So if you're interested, perhaps we could look at you scanning the Egyptian mummy. So that was very, very exciting. It took about 2 years before this whole project got together because we had to have endless meetings. We had to have permission from various curators. We had to establish how we were going to get the mummy up to the John Radcliffe. She did think I was going to take it in the back of our Renault Espace. And the day before I was due to leave, I mentioned it to the director, and he said, under no circumstances. So it went off in a sort of Brinks map high security van in the end. And This was a child mummy. They didn't know if it was a boy or a girl. And she was so excited. She said, it's going to be like, I'm going to be a mother and I'm going to find out it's going to be like the birth of a child, whether it's a boy or a girl. So here we are on the way to be scanned. And I kept it very quiet because I was rather nervous about the fact that it was going to be scanned at the John Radcliffe. But in fact, there were so many press there when we turned up. And look how tiny he is. And the chap on the left is Chris Alvey, who is one of the brilliant chaps who's collaborated with me over the years. And there you can see the mummy. You can just see the bandaging and the gold studs. And there he is, about to go in now. And that was the first picture. Because quite often, as you might know this, I didn't know this, but quite often there was just nothing. There was just rags and some bones in mummies that these chaps were really not very trustworthy. But on this occasion, there was definitely something in there when we saw the toes. So you can see that little toe. And that was the first sight of the child. And there is a scan of the child here. You can see just down here, you can see his toes and his extraordinary shape of his head, that skull. Now these chaps are Egyptian. What happened was, I was creating this little boy in my studio. I wanted to create him life-size from the scans. We had 2,500 CT scans, and I wanted to create him just as he was, so that he would be there floating in glass, free of his bandages. And I started with the head, and as this little boy was taking form in my studio, I felt a sort of eerie closeness. It was quite extraordinary. Thinking, you know, as a mother, that this little boy would have had a mother, and how did he grow up, and all the sort of things about this chap, I thought I must try and go to where he was interred, where he'd been taken 2,000 years ago, and taken to Oxford in this strange and alien country. So I went to see the Egyptologist, and she told me he was from Hawara in the Fayum, which is southwest of Cairo. And she said, you can go, I have never been, but I will give you a map that Flinders Petrie gave to the Ashmolean in 1888. And it was very exciting. He just marked with a little X, suggesting that that was the tomb where the boy had been taken from. And all it suggested was that he marked it as limestone blocks. So I set off on my own, and I had a guide in Cairo who was driving down with me, and we were stopped at a roadblock, and there was a great haroush. I didn't know what was going on. And suddenly I was given these police officers. There was four of them in the back of a jeep, and they accompanied me wherever I went on my search for the child mummy. There is quite a, I think that they were afraid that of a single woman and the risk of kidnapping. And there is the pyramid. It's really collapsed. It's made of mud bricks. And I did try to get in, but it's flooded. And we went wandering round and round, and then suddenly we came to what seems like, possibly, the area where the little boy came from. From the same tomb where other mummies that are in the British Museum and the Ashmolean with the Fayum portraits. The little boy didn't have a portrait. Some children did have portraits, but the little boy didn't. So it was from a mass grave. So it could have been there. And when I got there, I had decided before I went there that I wanted to bring back the sound. I somehow wanted to reunite the little boy with his homeland. And I sat down after everyone had gone, and I suddenly felt compelled. I wanted to do more than that, and I just emptied my water bottle and filled it with sand because I thought maybe I could take back the sand. This little boy will probably never leave Oxford, and here he was in this was his home, and it was very disturbing to see in this site these bandages that had just been discarded, and as you can see, submerged bone in this site. Can you see the bandaging that just been left? nobody around, no tourists, no archaeologists. It was just like an abandoned site. So I went to the little boy's village, the village next door, and I just wanted to really film and photograph these little chaps who would have been his brothers 2,000 years on. And if you go on my website, which I could give you later if you're interested, I did take a film of this adventure. And there I am with my camera and these little chaps. So he was probably about this age. So back in Oxford, I finished creating this little boy. And this was the exhibition. The Egyptologist at the Ashmolean said, you simply must have the little boy at your exhibition. And it was incredibly special. I never thought in my wildest dreams that I would be able to have the little boy at the exhibition. So he came down on a Brinks map van. And it was an extraordinary, he'd been in Oxford since 1888. And suddenly he was coming down the M40. And I was getting phone calls to say, we're coming into London, we're in Baker Street. Another call, we're coming down New Bond Street. I couldn't believe it, as this little boy, this fragile little person was coming into the exhibition. And if you can see here, you see these round discs. I was also very interested in the bandaging. So I made this sort of the protective shell that had taken care of this little boy. So when I was in Egypt, I bought linen and I came back and I bound them and made them into discs. And the ones I think you could maybe just see on the wall, there's the one in red, blue, and yellow. And because I studied the dyes that they would have used at that time in Egypt. So the red is the madder, and the blue is the woad, and the yellow is the weld. And that was, I had those dyed from plants. So there he is going in with the curator from the Ashmolean. And there she is laying him very carefully. There was a temperature controlled, a very special casing made for him. And if you can see just on the right there, there's a sort of strange white shape. That's actually his skull, because not his real skull, but a skull that I had made of him. And it looks absolutely magnificent. It was made by a medical company that where if you've been in a car accident, for example, and half your face is smashed up, they take a scan of the left side and they could recreate the right side. So we got this amazing skull made of him. And again, if you look on my website, you'll see the skull. But here is a little chap. And there is my recreation of him, which is now, there's a series of three of these. And I'm absolutely thrilled to say that the first one I made is here in Abu Dhabi. It was bought by the Shaker and is in the Royal Palace. So I felt spiritually, at least this little boy in a way has been returned to the Arab land. And the other one is in the permanent collection of the Ashmolean. So if you ever have a chance to go to the Ashmolean, you will see the little boy next to the recreation of him. And you can see, we find out all sorts of things about him. We found out that he had hip dysplasia. So if you stand and look at him, you can see his hips are misaligned. So he would have walked with quite a pronounced limp. He also had, in order to get to understand, establish his age, we sent scans to a specialist called Dr. Mary Lewis at Reading University, who specializes in small children, small mummies, but also to the pediatric dentist who had fitted the braces of my daughter. And he rang up and he was terribly excited because he said, this is a very special little boy. Because he only has two teeth where we all have four here. He's missing his side teeth. So he got really like rabbit teeth. And 0.4% of children born today have this disorder. He is a special little chap, and there he is on his side. I created one on his side. That's just his head here, which I engraved. And there he is. I wanted to show him from three positions. And in fact, I may try and bring this piece out and have it exhibited at New York University campus, who knows? Because here you can see him from all aspects. There he is again. And you can see his tiny little toes. Now this chap suddenly comes up because I'm talking about what makes the exploration of the visible and the invisible. I don't know if anybody would recognize this chap. He's been made a little bit more famous recently. He's Kepler, the great astronomer. And NASA, I don't know if any of you have been following this, but NASA has been tracking an area of space, a chunk of space, looking for habitable planets. And last year, I went to a Google conference. I was invited to join some scientists at a Google conference, and I met an astrophysicist, and he said, I've seen the mummy in the Ashmolean, and the way it floats as if suspended in midair. I wonder if you could perhaps think about capturing space in air. So again, it's something that is unseen to all of us, being made visible by technology, and it seemed to be quite an exciting prospect. So here we see the area of space. It's in Cygnus and Lyra. That these are the photometers that you see in these squares. And the Kepler telescope has discovered about 2,700 planets, which are circling around 1,700 odd stars, host stars. With the Goldilocks planets are the ones that they're looking for. They're called Goldilocks, not too hot and not too cold, because they reckon that the temperatures are just about right to sustain life. And as one scientist put it, if you think about it like this, Angela, it's a planet that you could make a cup of tea on without being fried to death, but you're not going to freeze to death either. So there's a possibility that there is water on these planets, and there's about 40. And here we have, I will show you now, there we have the Kepler search for space. So we are looking, the first star is probably about 130 light years from Earth. And it goes right through to about 4,300 light years, it can see. So what I conceived to do was to take each sheet of glass, to take 18 sheets of glass, and each one would represent 250 light years from space. So that is the piece that I created. Now you can see that the stars are just in circles, but the potential habitable ones, the Goldilocks ones, are opaque. There they go. And I've brought you back to me again, just to bring us back to the human body and looking at the visible, the invisible. And when I showed a piece of this work, I was quite interested to see a comment that someone made. I showed you earlier the different parts of the body, of my body, that that had been scanned on the MRI. And someone sent quite an interesting note. And he wrote, most people have an innate disconnect with these forms because they're not readily perceived. The body consists of compartmentalized systems that join to form a continuity. This is evident in the numerous medical specialties that exist. Using MRI and CT scanning, one can image the entire body, but never all at once, as you saw here. The complexities of entire systems are stratified to aid our understanding. However, the stratification in and of itself is a man-made creation that serves to unnaturally divide the human body. This is where Ms. Palmer's work comes to light. By combining these discretized planes, she contextualizes these relatively alien contours and features into a medium that her viewers can relate to and on a subconscious level recognize. And Jeanette Winterson, the novelist, said, Freud and Jung made the inside of our heads fashionable. The inside of our bodies are still taboo. In the context of the exposed inside-out body, she observed, our separate personalities are temporarily erased, freeing us from the worry of self into a united place that all of us share. And it is in this united place that makes art possible. It is a form of art, she concludes, that is intensely liberating. Well, to conclude, it's the collaboration, the time, the generosity of scientists that give artists like me the opportunity and the technical, importantly, the technical capability to experiment, to explore and to move forward. Just as importantly, they bring their own perspectives and their own creativity, so that every project really, for me, is a team effort. And I've never encountered anything but enthusiasm and cooperation every time I've approached a scientist or a specialist. And I suppose we recognize in each other a common need, almost an urgency to explore and to experiment, a shared curiosity to find new ways of looking, of seeing, of explaining, and of representing ourselves and the world around us, and importantly, making the invisible visible, in showing a new reality. And long may that continue. Thank you so much for listening.
I'm a crystallographer, and I actually made back in the 60s, I made some of those sheets.
How splendid!
And I'm curious, did you ever meet Dorothy Hodgkin and share the excitement of seeing the image come up? Because, I mean, that image you showed, that was the structure of vitamin, of penicillin, that actually won her the Nobel Prize.
Yeah.
And I wonder if you shared the experience of seeing the image come up as you build up these layers.
Yeah, sadly, no, she died. It's extraordinary because she was in North Oxford, where I live,
right,
and at Somerville College. She taught Margaret Thatcher. No more about that. But she died. It's so sad. But I did get to borrow that model for an exhibition I had at the Hunterian Gallery, the Surgeons Gallery in London. And so we did have I always credit Dorothy Hodgkin because it's interesting anyway. And I think I think it adds fascination to the work. Always credit her, but sadly, I never met her. But she has just been recognized, I mean, not as much as she should be in Oxford, but there is a bust, a bronze of her has gone into the Natural History Museum. But I think there should be a proper statue of Dorothy Hodgkin. She's one of the very few women, isn't there? I think maybe two or three women won the Nobel Prize for Science, and she was one of them.
Alone.
She won alone. Amazing woman. Well, then my next plans. Well, I wanted, I've got quite a few different ideas. There's always ideas rumbling away. One of the ideas I've got is to look at drinking water and the amount of drinking water that's available to the world, to countries in the world. Because we've got, with our increasing population explosion that we face, there's going to be water wars. It's going to be a major, major problem. And everyone recognizes that, but what to do? And again, it's like, maybe I could visually express this. So I got some figures from WHO and the UN, and every year they publish figures, a percentage of population that has access to safe drinking water in every country in the world that they can get figures for. So my idea, it's a very simple one, and logistically a lot less nightmarish than the Ghost Forest, is to take, if you imagine a long line, with just holes in the ground, and the amount of water coming from each hole in the ground will be representative of the percentage of drinking water available to each percent, the population in each country. So you'll start with very high spouts, and then you'll just end up at the very end with just a discernible trickle. And there is a country at the moment, the figures, the lowest one is 13% of the population has access to safe drinking water. And that's in Afghanistan. And of course, with this comes disease and all the other problems. And I was just saying to someone, an interesting statistic was thrown up there, because you imagine all countries in the EU would be up in the, you know, up with 100%. But actually, there's one country that's got 56% access to safe drinking water, and that's Romania, which is surprising. And they've contaminated their water. It's the most polluted place in Europe, and they've diverted the rivers for industry. So anyway, the idea, of course, of these projects is that not, as Heidi was saying, I resist the label activist. I'm not an activist, but I want to spark debate. And so people could see this fountain just as an elegant fountain, as any fountain is elegant. But other people might want to come and identify their countries and might want to just ask questions and might want to start debating and look to the future.
You spoke a few times in your talk about taking recordings of sound from the places that you've been. And earlier there was a reference to a project that you were working on regarding sutures of the brain and music. And I was wondering if you could speak to that.
Yes, it was quite funny. Heidi said that I had taken the sound of the suture skull of my own head, but in fact, it wasn't. I don't think, but I might be wrong, you can tell us, I don't think you could actually get to the point where you can show the suture lines very distinctly with radiography, or certainly with MRI scans, could you? Excellent. Right, well here's a plan. Because I had the skull of a Victorian woman, and I was in Scotland on holiday, and I was looking at some sheep's bones. I was telling Heidi, I used to be called Bones when I was a child at school, because when we went out on school trips, I was all up in the hills of Scotland, I was always collecting bones. But on a more recent holiday, I was looking at the suture lines on the skull of a sheep, and I said to my children, who are quite musical and I am not, do you think, this looks like a musical score, do you think we could set this to music? So when I got back to Oxford, my art teacher had a skull, a Victorian lady skull. So I took this to a professor at the Royal College of Music, and he took a virtual needle down the line of the suture skull and created some music from this. And if you go on the internet, you can hear the music and this MRI scan that was done of me in Aberdeen going through. So where I was in that crouched position, I got a film together of just going through my body that way with the sound of the suture line. So if we could do my own suture line, that'd be even more exciting.
Have you felt a sort of responsibility to merge the science and the art together? Because here we have a cardiologist that maybe can see something completely different thanks to your art, or a crystallographer that can see completely something that he wouldn't have seen before if you wouldn't have done this sort of art. So I just wanted to ask.
Well, I mean, I think that's what's so exciting is just seeing eyes opening, and I'm always up for collaborations and people's ideas. And sometimes like this astrophysicist, when he saw the Egyptian mummy in the Ashmolean, and he thought that we could translate the data he had into taking a chunk of space, which is certainly not something I'd contemplated before. Piece, by the way, I think is going to the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum in Washington. So, and then to Harvard's astrophysics, possibly, which is all part of the Smithsonian project. What's funny also is that I think the Kepler has just picked up something very exciting, which is a planet circling a pair of stars, which has never been seen in space before. And I checked out, and I think it's 4,700 light years away from Earth, which means I've got to do another sheet. It's all, I always get excited by collaborations because there's so many things I can't see that other people can see with their data, which I can then perhaps turn into work. So it is mapping, and it's making that looking beneath and beyond now.
I would like to ask you if you are familiar with the work of Masaru Emoto about photographing the water in different forms, the crystals of water that have been influenced by a prayer in contrast to water that is polluted. And you can actually see the difference. I know that some people are not very open to this kind of invisible world that is going on between us, but actually the aura of water, that is his thesis, is that it's gonna be influenced by our thoughts and by our minds. And I was thinking that you can do a research about this and implement this in your future about drinking water.
Yes, yes, exactly.
And it's very nice.
And I think,
another
sorry.
Thing is yeah. that I'm from Romania, and I know that we have a lot of problems regarding water, but we're gonna work on that because I'm here to make
Excellent.
Sure of that.
Good woman. No, that's very good news, and it is really just. In fact, I met a Romanian last night who said I had no idea. So, again, the other project that I'm working on, which may be of interest, I'm not sure, but it's one on climate change and the melt in the Arctic. And there's a community in northwest Greenland. It's a community that's very interesting because it's been cut off from the rest of the world until the early 1900s. So they had their own language and their own folklore, their own stories that have been handed down through generations. And it wasn't until a boat arrived in the Victorian times, a ship arrived in the Victorian times, that they realized there were other people in the world. However, this community, it's an Inuit community, it's melting. And the scientists reckon that in 10 years' time, this community will have had to disperse. And an etymologist from Cambridge spent a year living with this community to record the language. He learned the language, he recorded it, he wanted to digitize it and give it to the people of this community. And my idea really is to take a block of ice and engrave into this ice block a story from their own culture in their language, and set it into a cabinet which will be temperature controlled. So as they melt, this block of ice melts, and have this cabinet in various capitals of the world. So people can see that it's happening not tomorrow, not next week, not next year, but over this 10-year span. And just to appreciate what is going on in other parts of the world. So making this very visible, really. The disappearance visible.
Do you think your work with MRIs, and particularly the segmentation they encourage, has influenced your sensibility when approaching other projects, like the water project, for example?
I don't know if it's influenced the water project. I think it's a lot of it comes back to mapping and my desire to somehow visually create tell the story. One of my, I think a lot of my work is influenced by my background in journalism. So when I was working on the Observer magazine, for example, I was very much, I was involved in telling stories, but the written story with obviously with the visuals, but the writing was predominant there. And now I'm sort of telling the same kind of stories, but visually. Although I do sometimes write pieces about the work in newspapers. So whether, I don't know, I think the work has the common theme of mapping, curiosity, and looking into the future.
Have you ever had any contact with Edward Tufte?
Edward Tufte, no. I don't know Edward Tufte. Tell me.
The man who's written these books about envisioning information.
Oh, I'd like, so I, how do I spell his surname?
T is his family name, T-U-F-T-E.
Okay, I'll check him out. That sounds like a good one for me to check out, because it's all about contacts, communication, more information, and that's what I feel about a lot of the projects. I hope that my projects inspire people to look more, just to see things differently, to see this new reality, which is really, I guess, the theme tonight, so. It's just being jackdaws, really, with your eyes. Thank you very much indeed.